And so I want to start this off about a story that started in 2011. Let's see if it rings any bells. I had a Knicks blog at the time, was writing every day and was communicating with you back and forth. And I wanted to go to your book signing for the Thank You Economy back in March of 2011 in New York City. But my mom wouldn't let me go because it was a school night. And I text you or DM you rather, and I say, "Hey Gary, my mom won't let me go to this book signing. This is the issue I'm running into." And you said, "That's great. What's her number?" And you called her on the
Oh
spot,
my God, brother, that's you?
left her voicemail, and it is something that my college friends, I talk to my mom, we talk about to this day. So what compelled you to give your time of day to a 15-year-old kid? And what did you say to my mom to convince her that I should come to your book signing?
I don't want to lie, so I don't remember all the details of what I said, but I actually remember the setup to this. And I've done maybe like 7 to 12 calls in the last 10 years where I've had enough awareness on me that people would want such a thing. Bunch of answers. First of all, thanks for having me on the show. I mean, you are like winning the serendipity of my, you completely figured out how to hack my brain because here's another serendipitous moment. I also think you did a blog post that I left a comment to or something like that, right? I saw you say on Twitter. So you're clearly good at getting my attention or understanding what pulls at my heartstrings. I think what compels me is gratitude. Like I'm grateful. Like watching people respond, like me reading the tweets when I decided to do your podcast randomly the other night, and people thinking that was cool. I'm not ever gonna be a person who doesn't think that that's cool. Like I'm still the same person in my brain that I've been before anybody knew who I was. So for me to think I'm in a place in my life where people think it's cool that I'm doing this podcast, that like it's a big thing for you, for me to do this. Now listen, my admin team, my leadership team's mad that I'm doing this 30, not overall, but on December, 14th, we're closing budgets. There's a lot going on right now. Even I saw it this morning because I didn't know, I kind of thought we would do this at night one night, late night. And I was like, ugh, there's some real shit I gotta get done, but that's just operational. That's just valuing time. That's just taking care of your responsibilities. It's not big timing. I'll never be that person, and I'm just humbled by it. And what I probably told your mom is what I believe, which is if I was doing this right now for a 15-year-old, I'm like, look, in my soul, I believe the things that I talk about and where the world's going. And if you have a 15-year-old that's connecting to it, that this might just actually be a good use of time because all the things that you would do for homework on a school night is very likely not going to be more valuable than the people you learn or some of the ideas that will be put into your head at night. And so, I'm sure your mom appreciated the effort. I'm stunned by people's lack of effort or appreciation or gratitude towards their communities. It's why I engaged some of the people that were not as into me in your comments and saying I'm sucky or, it was really funny. I replied to one of them, was like, I can't win. Either I'm pushing people to not sleep and work too hard, or I'm pushing people to be too patient and not go about getting that money. And I was laughing. I'm like, it's an unwinnable game. And I think context is everything. But the reason I engaged in some of those comments, Danny, is because I appreciate them having opinions. Like I know that nobody really knows me. Right? You don't really know. People that are closest to you know, and like people are making perceptions, and like the world's crazy. People make up shit. Like, man, people have taken photos with me at the airport and then posted on LinkedIn that we had a business meeting. People have said not nice things about me in public or private because I didn't give them money for their startup and they just make up stuff. Like life's complicated. And so as you start getting more notoriety and you get more cheering and booing, you kind of got to go into this zen place of like, hey, I'm going to try to do all the best right things. And at the end of the day, when I'm old and I die, more people will cheer than boo because only so many people are willing to make up shit. And so that's kind of how I navigate.
It's a beautiful place to be. And from what I've seen looking at you for the past 11 years, is that same guy. I started following your content when I was 13 years old, and something in me saw that this person is gratitude. This person is looking out for the best in people. And it was that attracted me to you and to your content. And for that, I'm really grateful. So, my question to you, my follow-up is, what do you do? Where do you go to that place when you see all those negative comments? What is going through your head? How are you navigating that into a positive, into empathy? What's practically going on in your head?
You know, one, it's a blend of a couple things. Hey, maybe they caught something I said. First, it's accountability. Hey, maybe I didn't do a good job explaining something on a podcast and it turned that person off. Hey, maybe we didn't edit an Instagram clip well enough and the context was lost, even though I write the copy always to like set up the video. Maybe they didn't read the copy. Maybe I fired their best friend and they thought I was unfair because their best friend didn't tell them the whole picture. Maybe, you know, I go through those series of things, and then I go into the macro. Maybe they're unhappy and, you know, they just want to tear somebody down today and I just happen to be in the feed that day. Maybe they took my advice of being patient and it was too patient and they lost and they're like, fuck Gary B, and they don't want the accountability. It's more fun to point the finger. So for me, first I focus on pointing my thumb at myself. What have I done to make people misunderstand or maybe misconstrue? You know, when everybody tries to say that I talk about overworking yourself and hustle porn, I'm like, man, I didn't do a good enough job in my early career to talk about this was contextual to the time. You know, the economy collapsed, people were out of jobs, people were hurting, the internet was exploding, it was a huge opportunity. And even though I talked about being happy and doing it for $50,000 a year, if it makes you happy, for some reason, maybe my Jersey energy, maybe because I didn't do a good enough job clarifying along the way, maybe I let that word hustle get too attached to me and didn't, I still love hustle. It's called work ethic. Nobody's gonna fucking do anything without work ethic. It's not gonna happen in a meaningful way. But I don't, that doesn't mean I'm talking about burnout or suicide or unhappiness. As a matter of fact, the reason I think I talk about so much of not doing it for the cars and the rides and the jewelry and the trips is because I think that usually means people want affirmation from others that they've made it. And that if you care about other people's opinions that way, you become very vulnerable. And I don't want that for people because that's what leads to unhappiness, because there's always going to be somebody richer, more famous, prettier, bigger car. You know what I mean? You get into this cycle. So, you know, and by the way, the other place I go, my friend, I don't expect everybody to consume 19 hours of my content and have every T and I crossed. You know, there's a reason that people that have more consumption of my content feel better about it because they've been able to see it contextualize versus somebody seeing 3 viral videos ever and deciding that's who I am. So what goes through my mind is they're right because they're a human being and that's their opinion. And I've got to do a better job clarifying. I didn't talk about the fact in the first 10 years of my career that my dad owned Wine Library and I didn't, because I felt like, to be frank, to be very transparent, I felt like, man, I really built a huge business for my dad and I left and I didn't want people to think my dad was a bad guy. You know, I knew that a lot of Americans don't know about immigrant family businesses where, you know, like I didn't want my dad to look bad that I built something for $4 to $60 million and I got nothing, woe is me. Oh my God, Sasha's such a dick, fucking child labor. You know, I didn't want that. So I overprotected him, but then that led to people being like, don't listen to this guy who was handed everything. I'm like, fuck that, I'm the reverse. I gave up the first 15 years of my career to build something for my dad, but still someone else. And I had to start VaynerMedia in a fucking conference room because I had no fucking money. So like, you know, that shit.